I first want to say that I'm honored that you should leave your comfortable and cozy homes on a rather crisp winter evening, walk over the ice, and come to hear me speak. Maybe that way of presenting it, hear me speak, isn't entirely what I have in mind, because I really see myself more as a discussion leader. I'm familiar with my own ideas, to the point that I'm bored with them. And the reason I accept invitations to speak is actually to engage in discussion with people, to test my ideas, to discover new ideas. Discussion is, in fact, rare. One of the reasons I hardly ever watch the talk shows on TV, the Sunday morning shows, and MSNBC and Fox News, is they're never discussions. They're hardly even debates. They're just people shouting at each other. They're people defending their turf. Have you ever heard someone say, you know, that's a pretty persuasive argument. Let me think about why I think I disagree with that. And even be open to the possibility of changing their minds. You never have any sense that there's any possibility that anyone in any one of these programs will change their mind. That's not a discussion. What I have in my classes, but the one most relevant to tonight, which is a class in U.S. foreign policy, which I teach to graduate students, is a discussion. I am the discussion leader, but what I tell the students the very first day is that when we come to a discussion of policy, particularly when it comes to your final exam, and the final exam will be a discussion of policy, that is, I'll give you a scenario, or this year I said, you have been hired as personal assistant on foreign policy to the president-elect. Originally, I referred to her. And by the time I gave him the exam, I had made an adjustment, a gender adjustment. I said, you're asked to suggest to the president what are the five most important issues he will have to confront and how he ought to confront them. And you may have an idea of what I think about those issues, but don't think that it will be any advantage to you to reiterate or to express my ideas, because I don't care how you come out on your ultimate policy suggestion. All I'm interested in is how you get there, which is a process of thought. What are your premises? Are you aware of your premises? Are you aware of the ideas about cause and effect that you bring to the table? Are you aware of the other opinions in this area? Have you canvassed them? And if you're not persuaded by them, obviously you're not, because you came to a different policy conclusion, why not? If you can do those things, you get an A, obviously. And if you don't, well, you do less well than that. And by the time the course is over, I think I have persuaded students that I truly don't care where they come out, because one thing I discovered, both being in government and observing government for, well, about 50 years, is that policy judgments are always uncertain because there are so many variables. It's so hard to predict what the output will be from the input, because what we're talking about is international relations. And that means you make moves, other actors have interests, they make moves, you respond to their moves, and often you have misunderstood them, they've misunderstood the signals you have sent out, you misunderstood the signals they send back to you, and so it goes. There's a strong element of uncertainty, inevitable element of uncertainty in foreign policy making, and that doesn't mean that it's an incoherent or entirely chancy process. If you're unable to see the connection between different actions, different events in the world, if you take each event as a discrete event, unconnected to other events, then the likelihood of having an efficient foreign policy, a secure foreign policy, the likelihood of optimizing the pursuit of our national interests is a sheer matter of chance. So what I start off doing with the students is suggesting some questions that they ought to ponder throughout the course. And they probably have some initial views about them, and they should ask themselves how they arrived at those views and keep thinking about those general questions. So I've written down, well, not all the questions that I posed to them, but a few, which I think are tremendously important for deciding how each of us would resolve is too strong a word, but at least to address the great issues of our time, the great issues that President Trump is going to have to address whether he wants to or not. So one of the questions is, in fact, the first four questions are related. One of the questions is, should U.S. policymakers take account of the impact of our policies on other peoples? Well, people could differ on that. You could say, no. We have to look to our interests. We then carry out our policies, and whatever the impact is, we hope it's in an ideal world, it would be good for both of us. But if it isn't, if it's only good for us, so what? That is the way that some people think about foreign policy. They may pretend otherwise, but sometimes they don't even pretend. I think of a woman I came to know well when I proposed successfully the renaming of the Graduate School of International Studies to the Josef Korbel School of International Studies. As some of you may know, Josef Korbel is the father of Madeleine Albright. And I proposed renaming the school for the usual reason that deans do things, to raise money. You thought I was going to say something else? Now, if I thought Joe Korbel was a terrible person, I might have hesitated, for a moment at least. But in fact, I hear that he was a fine gentleman, a real scholar, diplomat. But still, I understood what my reasons were. And I got to know Madeleine fairly well as a consequence. And one day, I asked her about Iraq sanctions. Remember, after the first Gulf War, the War of 1991, we imposed sanctions on Iraq, severe economic sanctions. And according to estimates based upon mortality studies, those sanctions, for complicated reasons, resulted in the death of about 500,000 Iraqi people. I have Afghanistan on the mind. Iraqi people, mostly between the ages of 1 day and 5 years, that is very young people. There was an obvious increase in the mortality rates. And if you wanted me to go into it, I could explain why. But it was, of course, it was partially a consequence of Saddam Hussein's policies, his decisions about how to use the limited resources that he had, limited as a consequence of the sanctions. But the sanctions played an important role. They were a contributing cause. And Madeleine didn't question the fact that it had caused these deaths. But she said, well, one of the consequences of carrying out the policy was the right policy. So, and I don't think Madeleine is a bad person. I'm just saying that this illustrates a case of someone saying, well, the impact on other peoples is unfortunate. The second question is, should we use U.S. resources to try and help other peoples? It's a slightly different question. What would be an example of that? Well, there aren't too many, actually. If we're talking about military resources, of course, a great power like the United States has all kinds of resources. Military is just one of them. But one of the rare examples I always cite to people of probably genuine humanitarian intervention was the intervention in Somalia in 1992, in December of 1992, when there was mass famine in Somalia, growing out of the civil conflict in that country. And it was projected that at least a million people could die of starvation. And thousands were dying every day. And in the last year of his presidency, George H.W. Bush decided that there was a plea from the Secretary General, and he decided, although his instincts to do humanitarian interventions were negative, he decided to do it. And he said, if we get a Security Council resolution authorizing us to do it, we will mobilize the forces to go in and make sure that the aid is delivered to the center of the famine area, because it wasn't throughout the country. It was in one part of the country, a fairly densely populated part of the country. And we did. And it was successful. People think of Somali intervention in terms of the ultimate results, Black Hawk Down. Some of you may remember, some of you may have seen the movie. But that was a later stage. But the first, and that was the stage after the UN took over. That wasn't, this is a complicated question, it wasn't the UN's fault necessarily, but the US-led piece of it was feed and leave. And that was successful. So that's an example of using US resources, not vast resources, but significant resources, to actually try and help other people for no reason other than to try and help other people. Not every political leader that we have had or have today would support that. And as I said, George Bush thought about it before deciding to do it. So I think that is a legitimate question. It's not a rhetorical question. Third question is, should we use our power to promote democratic government and human rights? It's a slightly different question. It's related, but it's slightly different. Those policy intellectuals we label neoconservatives have advocated that. In the wake of the collapse of the Soviet Union in 1993, well, you can date it from different points, but 1993 is probably a conventional date, they said, Soviet Union is gone. It's actually dissolved. It doesn't exist anymore, leaving us as the unipower. We can do whatever we want in the world. They were wrong. They didn't appreciate the costs of trying to do whatever we want, but they thought we could. And they said, what we should do is use this window of opportunity to build democracies around the world, particularly in the Middle East, and that this will incidentally be good for the peoples of the Middle East, but it will definitely be good for us, because those countries will be natural allies of the United States and make it much easier for us to carry out our policies and achieve our interests in the Middle East. So I think that too is a legitimate question, not a rhetorical one. And finally, in this cluster of questions, should we invest resources in rebuilding governments when they collapse, or when we collapse them, as the case may be? And that remains a highly controversial issue. And it's interesting that when George W. Bush ran for office successfully, he distinguished himself from the Clinton administration by saying, we're not engaged in welfare projects, we're not engaged in nation building, we are going to define our national interests in a very straightforward way, we're going to concentrate our resources in advancing those interests. Then came 9/11, and suddenly we were engaged in a crusade for democracy in changing the regimes of states and rebuilding failed states, because once we took out the regime in Iraq, well, it was a failed state at that point. Similarly, in Afghanistan clearly was a case of a failed state. It had been a failed state since before the Soviet invasion in 1979. All right, that's one cluster of questions I ask students to keep in mind as we move on to look at specific issues: China, Russia, the Middle East, terrorism, and so on. I also ask them the question of, should the U.S. generally comply with international law? I'm trained as a lawyer, so I have some interest in the subject. But that leads to a discussion of what are the essential elements of a legal system? And I then do give a little lecture about that. And I then ask, well, is there a close analogy between the international, I put it in quotation marks, international legal system and national legal systems? Or are they really fundamentally different? Now, some American analysts, spokesmen, political leaders say, well, they're fundamentally different. John Bolton, former ambassador to the United Nations, said there's no such thing as international law. There are political understandings, perhaps, but if they don't serve our interests, we should feel free to violate them. We shouldn't feel any moral qualm about violating them, because it's not like violating law. Well, it leads to an interesting discussion with the class about what functions, we won't use the word law, what functions this vast body of rules and principles serve in international relations, whether we call them law or not. In a way, that kind of begs the question. But I do point out that there's no international transaction that you can think of, whether it's founding a national airline to fly around the world, or deciding what resources of the sea you have access to, or deciding when you can use force. Or the rules of trade, let's say. There's no cross-border interaction which doesn't have rules and principles attached to it, which are the rules and principles which have been arrived at through a process of negotiation, discussion, debate, out of which some rough consensus has emerged. That's all I mean, but that's a lot, by international law. And then I repeat the question, so should the U.S. generally comply, and if so, why? If not, why not? And another somewhat related question, but it's a subset of that, how do we decide whether the use of force is justified? And then I take them through what began as the Catholic just war tradition, starting with St. Augustine and then Thomas Aquinas, and refined by many other Catholic theologians, and then gradually it became secularized, became incorporated into secular discourse. And today, when I think even people who never read or thought about Augustine or Aquinas or Catholic theology tend to use these criteria somewhat intuitively to decide whether a war is or is not justified. Well, I want to bring those criteria into the forefront of students' minds. Then I ask them to deliberate internally, initially, on how do we decide which countries are friends and which countries are enemies. After all, I said, some countries that once were friends are now enemies. And if we look historically, I take them back to that famous quotation from Lord Palmerston about the former foreign minister of Britain in the 19th century, when he said, Great Britain has no permanent friends and no permanent enemies. It has permanent interests. Remember that? And I say, well, was he right? Is that true? Or do you have permanent friends? If so, why do you have permanent friends? How do countries become enemies? Iran was an ally of ours at one point. Now it's a bitter enemy. What was the process by which a country was transformed? In our mind, because ultimately all foreign policy is subjective. It has to be subjective. Who's making the decisions? People. People are making decisions based upon their view of the way the world works. So, in a sense, everything is subjective, including conceptions of the national interest. I know some people talk about the national interest if it's like this podium. It's something out there, it's fixed, you just have to identify it, and then you proceed from there. But ultimately, everything out there is filtered through our minds And when you have a serious discussion about the national interest, you'll find people have very different ideas of what the U.S. national interest is. Once you get beyond the obvious, which is territorial integrity and political independence, but a great power like ourselves, still the most powerful country by far in the world, with pleasantly weak neighbors to our north and south, and two great oceans around us, we don't have to worry about political independence and territorial integrity. Maybe we will someday, but we don't have to now. So then, once you get beyond that, then it becomes less clear. And people's views may be affected by many things. By their, all of us come ultimately from some diaspora, from some immigrant population. We were all, or our forefathers and mothers are all immigrants at some point, and many people feel an association with the old country. And they think the national interest should include doing things that benefit the old country. I'll give you an example of that. After the dissolution of the Soviet Union, Congress passed legislation appropriating money to assist the former parts of the Soviet Union to develop themselves, to move toward democratic government, and to be friends of ours, of course. And there was money for every single former entity within the Soviet Union, except one. What was that? What was that one? No, no, certainly not. Azerbaijan. And Azerbaijan was one of the more important countries, not because it's very big, because it has lots of oil. So why was that the one country we weren't going to give any assistance to? Well, because it had very unfriendly relations with Armenia. And there is an Armenian lobby. I don't say it critically, I say it as a fact. There's an Armenian lobby, and there's some very prominent people in the country, one of them on reality TV, who are Armenian in background. For those of you who never watch reality TV, there is the Kardashians. You didn't think of that. And so, you know, most legislators, most members of Congress, they hardly knew anything about Azerbaijan or Armenia. So when they're approached by an organized group, which have some resources to donate to campaigns, and they say, Azerbaijan is a very bad place, they shouldn't get any money. Okay, they said, so no money for Azerbaijan in the appropriation. Well, was that in our national interest? According to some people, it was. So the national interest can be a somewhat uncertain category. Anything else? Any other questions that people, that I ask my class to take into account? Or here's one. How can we distinguish between reasonable compromise and weak-kneed appeasement? That is not an easy one. You know? We may be faced with this question very shortly. Suppose President-elect Trump, soon to be President Trump, so I'll refer to him as President Trump, and Mr. Putin get together in the near future, which seems quite likely. They sit down, and Trump says, well, let's do a deal. And Putin says, I love to do deals. And I know that you are eager to reset relations. It's interesting that the Obama administration began by saying, we're going to reset relations with Russia. And the Bush administration began by saying, we're going to reset relations with Russia. Remember, Bush had Putin come to his ranch, and he said, I've looked into his soul, and he's a good man. Well, George W. changed his mind. And maybe Donald Trump will change his mind. But let's assume that Putin says, all right, one thing we want, if we're going to have a nice, warm, fuzzy, cooperative relationship, we want you to recognize that Crimea is part of Russia. Okay? And we want it understood that Ukraine is in our sphere of influence, as is Georgia, as are all the countries of the Caucasus, as are all the countries of the former Soviet Union. Now, if if Trump says, yeah, we get it. We understand that. It's geography, it's history, we understand that. Well, is that reasonable compromise or is that weak-kneed appeasement? Reasonable and unreasonable people may disagree about that. But in many cases, it is not clear. And if we look at, let's take the case of China. One of the potential flashpoints that the president, the new president, will have to face is Chinese policies in the South China Sea with respect to Taiwan and with respect to those islands which the Chinese call the Deo Islands and the Japanese call the Senkaku Islands, and they each claim sovereignty over those islands. And, well, the pressure is intensifying. Each party is making moves, particularly the Chinese, are making moves to turn rhetoric, to turn claims into facts on the ground. What position should the U.S. take on these issues? On the South China Sea, the Obama position has been these things should be settled, that the question of the South China Sea should be settled by negotiations among the interested parties, that is, the states that border the South China Sea. We haven't made a strong statement about what international law requires. There is a widely accepted view, not by the Chinese, that international law, that the Chinese claims to practically the entire South China Sea, is not consistent with international law as it exists today. The Chinese have rejected that arbitral finding by a group of distinguished jurists. I only raise this at this point to repeat the question of what kind of compromises should be made. Well, one of the questions is, what are we getting in return for the compromise? That helps us to decide whether or not it's a reasonable compromise or it is appeasement. But appeasement is such a loaded word. It doesn't help us very much. It's a word we use really to try to win arguments after we've decided that we're not going to compromise. And for the most powerful country in the world, it's kind of, and a country that has a fairly high opinion of itself, it's not easy to compromise. And I don't mean that in a cynical or snide way. I mean, I think it is naturally difficult for the most powerful actor in any relationship to decide to conciliate other parties when it feels it has the means to impose a solution. Of course, imposition always carries costs, and sometimes the costs aren't carefully calculated. All right, two more questions. How should we decide on the portions of public revenues to be devoted to our armed forces and to other foreign policy instruments? The diplomats, the intelligence services, the foreign aid organization, to all the instruments of foreign policy, or even within, or to the military, as opposed to the other instruments of foreign policy, on the one hand, and to improving life in the United States, on the other. How do we make that decision? Is there a rational way of making that decision? In the last few presidential elections, it has been primarily the Republican contender for the presidency who has said, we're not spending enough on the military. It hasn't always been a Republican theme. When John F. Kennedy ran for president, he said that the country had grown weak and that he was going to strengthen the country militarily. So it's not inevitably a Democratic theme, but in recent decades, it's been a Republican theme. But in the course of the electoral process, no presidential candidate ever mentions the fact, at least no Republican candidate ever mentions the fact, that we spend more on our armed forces than China, Russia, France, Britain, India, Indonesia, Pakistan, any other five countries you want to name, combined. So it's still, it's a lot of money. We do outspend them to a very large degree. But is it enough? Now, maybe the way I said it made it sound as if I knew the answer. And I don't think I do. That is, I think if I were asked, I would have some suggestions about an answer, but I would know where to start, even in, if I were acting on my own, to work out an answer, which is, all right, what are our core interests, right? What do we want to accomplish? And to what extent do we need to use military assets in order to accomplish those ends? Then I look at the assets we have, and I compare them to the assets that other parties have. But I also take into account that moves that we make, let's say to increase certain assets, will possibly motivate other countries to make moves to respond to our moves, so that by spending more, we don't necessarily end up in a better place. Well, it's international relations, so what I want of my students is to always think that when we make moves, other actors make moves, then we make moves in response to their moves, then they make moves in response to our moves. That is a dynamic process. And you have to try to think through the dynamics and see whether you're going to end up ahead. But I think you'll agree that that is an important question for a president to consider. And finally, how do we avoid too rigid a framework for making sense of the world at any given historical moment? Because the tendency of any state, particularly of a great power, is to try to establish a framework of understanding. We have certain goals. Those are the bad people. We are the good people. And this is what we need to do, because every day, if you're sitting in the White House or your Secretary of Defense, I worked in the Defense Department, partially for McNamara's chief advisor at the time, occasionally for the Secretary himself, every day reports are coming in from the intelligence services, from the embassies, from the newspapers about events around the world, which you're processing. And if you're a power with interests all over the world, almost any event could conceivably have some effect on your interests now or down the road. So how do you lend coherence to your response? How do you decide whether to respond at all or to say that's just a blip on the radar screen? So you tend to develop a framework, and then you stuff these events into that framework. Now, during the Cold War, we had a framework. Yeah. There are the communists, bad. There are us, good. All right. Anything that strengthens them, for example, if there's a change of regime in some country and a group come to power or threaten to come to power who declare themselves Marxist or even left-wing, probably bad. So let's see what we can do to prevent that happening. That was the framework. That was useful in many cases, but it led to a couple of disasters, at least. One was the Vietnam War. People who knew Vietnam well said, why are we getting involved in Vietnam? Vietnam and China have been enemies for a millennium. So even if a Marxist government comes to power in all of Vietnam, the likelihood of their having warm, fuzzy relations with the communist government of China is very small. And why don't we think of it as the Yugoslavia of Asia? We have, when Yugoslavia broke with Stalin, with the Soviet Union, we treated Yugoslavia as a de facto ally of the free world. Vietnam could be a de facto ally of the free world if we don't interfere with this process of achieving national independence as an integrated unit. Well, but we had the framework. The framework said we have to prevent the Marxist state from unifying the country. We paid a heavy price for that. But a more interesting case in some ways is Afghanistan. When the Soviets invaded in 1979, Zbigniew Brzezinski in particular, who was principal advisor on foreign policy to President Carter, and a very able man, I knew him slightly and was always impressed by him. I didn't always agree with him. I know he didn't always agree with me, if he even knew what I thought. But really a very able man. But he said, we can make Afghanistan the Vietnam of Russia, or the Soviet Union as it then was. We'll bleed them. So what did we do? We poured weapons into the insurgency, all kinds of weapons, and we encouraged, successfully, the Saudi Arabians, that is the Saudi Arabian government, to call for jihad against the infidel invaders of a Muslim country, Afghanistan. Because to many Muslims, the Soviet Union was Western. Yes, it was Marxist. Wasn't capitalist, but it was Western, and certainly it wasn't Muslim. So it was an infidel nation invading a Muslim country. And so the idea of a transnational, international jihad was born. And people from all over the Islamic world, volunteers, came to fight in Afghanistan against the Soviet Union. And the Soviet Union did bleed. They did indeed. And among the people who came to organize the resistance was Osama bin Laden. So we paid a price for too single-minded an approach to the problem because we had this very rigid framework for interpreting events. Okay. I want to leave, you know, you've had many speakers who say, I love discussion. And then, of course, they speak for the entire hour and a half, and end of discussion. So that's why I have my watch here. I'm looking at it. So I'm not going to say everything that I wanted to say to kind of set you, provoke you. But let me just say two things, if you'll allow me. One is this. Now, I'm going to put it in very simple terms. At the end of the Cold War, with the Soviet Union gone, the whole foreign policy establishment, and the people who write about foreign policy, the people who practice foreign policy, they said, well, okay, where do we go from here? The framework of our analysis for the past 50 years is gone. And roughly four views were articulated in the strategic journals, in insider circles, within the foreign policy and defense bureaucracies. And I'll just mention the four. I was going to elaborate a little bit, but we don't have time, although we could explore it a little bit in the discussion period. One was withdrawal from overseas military commitments. And the politician, the contemporary politician who comes closest to reflecting that view is Rand Paul. And the argument was, okay, we have been spending billions in current dollars, trillions of dollars for 60 years, and we've won. And now we can come home. We're still going to be the most powerful country in the world. Of course, our business people, our missionaries, our culture is going to be everywhere. So it's not that America is withdrawing from the world. It's that the American military is withdrawing. We can do it. And we should do it. And again, why not do it? Because we don't have any threats to our territorial integrity or political independence. That was one view. Not the most widely supported view, in fact, the least supported view. And you found some people on the left, far left can probably meet in a telephone booth in this country, But let's say the left, who supported that view. But there are also people on the right who supported that view. If you remember Pat Buchanan, that was Pat Buchanan's view. It was sort of a libertarian view. All right, that was one view. Second was, U.S. should be the offshore balancer. That's the right policy now. Now, what was our... We should play the same role in relation to the world that Britain played in relation to continental Europe in the 19th and indeed in the 18th century. That is, the British view was, we don't want to get involved in the quarrels of the continent. Unless there is a risk that one country, Napoleonic France, the Kaiser's Germany, or Hitler's Germany, could unify the continent, because then that country would become so powerful they would threaten us. So if we think that's going to happen, then we'll have to get involved, we'll have to put our finger on the scales of power. But otherwise, let them fight it out or balance each other, as the case may be. So the offshore balancer said, look, in the case of Asia, China's a rising power, but a combination of India, Japan, South Korea, Indonesia, Vietnam, they can balance China. They don't need us. And by being there, we prevent them from, or we don't, we reduce the incentives to spend the money and to engage in the cooperative activity to balance the Chinese. So actually, the balancing process will occur better if we take this offshore balancing approach. They said in Europe, same thing. You know, Russia is weak now, it might grow stronger, but France, a unified Germany, Europe as a whole, they can balance Russia. And if it turns out that it were wrong, or that over time the balance degrades, okay. We're still a country of immense power. We'll go put our finger on the scale. We'll re-involve ourselves to restore the balance. So that was the argument. The other two positions were sometimes referred to as unilateral globalists and multilateral globalists. The unilateral globalists were really the neoconservatives. They said, well, I've already suggested what their view was. We will act on our own. Of course, we're happy to have countries that go along with us, that support us, coalitions of the willing, as we came to call them. But we're not going to be inhibited by the compromises needed to work through multilateral institutions and large alliances. You know, in NATO, one country can veto a NATO operation. No, that's too inhibiting for a great power with enormous ambitions in the world. But they agreed with the multilateral universalists that the U.S. had interests everywhere, and that it was important to have not only a cultural presence and an economic presence, but a military presence everywhere to preserve, to guarantee the preservation of the international trading, or let's call it the liberal international economic system, which we built at the end of the Second World War. And any withdrawal, however gradual, would be destabilizing, or could be destabilizing. Why take the risk? But the multilateralists said, yeah, but not only is it immensely expensive to act, be prepared to act unilaterally, but you create enemies. You create resistance by not acting multilaterally, which does mean compromising with others' views of what are reasonable objectives and how to obtain them. All right? So the last thing I was simply going to say was, given the world as it is, what should U.S. foreign policy priorities be? And this is, or what are the flashpoints that we should be concerned about and that the new president will we'll have to face. And I just made a little list, the easiest thing I had to do. One was, and one and two are really almost two faces of the same point. Avoid great power conflict, a great power war. The First World War killed 20 million people. The Second World War killed 50 million people. That was all before nuclear weapons. All right. 1A is avoid the further proliferation of nuclear weapons and seek international agreement on reducing the present number of warheads and on strengthening systems of command and control for those countries that have them. Because the worst thing that can happen to us or to the world is a nuclear explosion. And that the more proliferation there is, the more likely it is that there will be use of a nuclear weapon. And just think that the bomb that destroyed Hiroshima and the bomb that destroyed Nagasaki is now an artillery shell. Could now be put in a suitcase, and was put in the suitcase by the Soviet Union. And just as a footnote, they never were able to account for all the suitcase bombs. Probably bad accounting. We hope it was bad accounting. But that's a fact. And then when you think of that as a mere tactical weapon, you realize that one warhead would presently have deployed could destroy all of New York City. You know, it's almost unthinkable, and yet it becomes more and more likely. And people that are inside the game, inside the Pentagon, believe that it is far more likely than not, just given projections from the way the world is going, that this will happen, and will happen within the next decade or so. Aside from that, my next priority would be to maintain the Western alliance. The European governments are under great stress today. Every one of them, great stress. And although I am not a conflict of civilizations person, the West Europe is the place from which our culture, our values come. We are a complicated country. We're not entirely a Western country, but we are still very much the product of the Renaissance and the Enlightenment and the Reformation and the Enlightenment. The European countries are our natural allies. They do share our values in large measure. And I think it would be disastrous for us on many counts if the Western alliance were to collapse. And fourth, I would try to strengthen international cooperation for responding to the many problems which simply can't be dealt with unilaterally. And just to mention one, which is pandemics. After all, the Spanish flu after World War I killed slightly more people than World War I. And our ability to deal with the new superbugs is declining. The danger of a pandemic, and in our globalized world with people moving constantly from place to place, the danger of a pandemic is very great. So I offer that as one example of a problem which can't even begun to be dealt with except within a multilateral framework and much closer relationships than we have today. Okay, I had a few other points, but they're much less important than what points you have to make. And so let me stop. And you don't have to make a comment disguised as a question. If you have a question, great. But if you have a comment, that's great too. And if you don't think I've answered your question, assume you ask a question, and I answer it, and you don't think I've really answered it, I've answered the question I wished you'd ask. put your hand up again and say a little follow-up, if you don't mind, and I'll try and answer the real question.
So we'll come around with the microphone, and thank you for raising your hand up high. I saw this one in the center right away, and I'll move from side to side. So I'll start here, then go west, and then back east.
Thank you. You haven't mentioned the problem of North Korea and the bomb.
Remember I said I decided I was just going to leave something out? North Korea was high on my list of flashpoints. In fact, it was second. The first one was China, as I said before. South China Sea, the Senkaku Islands, Taiwan. The second was North Korea. North Korea has been a continuing dilemma for administration after administration. Each administration says the prior administration wasn't tough enough. We're going to be tough and deal with the problem. Everything's been tried. Well, I mean, that we've tried negotiating, we've tried threatening. The problem is profound. I mean, it's almost insoluble because you have North Vietnamese artillery and rocket forces, but within 60 miles of Seoul. And at the outset of, let's say, an effort to decapitate North Korea or to take out their nuclear weapons and capacity and labs and so on and scientists, they would probably, almost, I'm sure they're under orders, to destroy Seoul. One third of the population of South Korea is in Seoul. What do you think the South Koreans would think about that? The only thing I can think of would be to simultaneously strike the capital of North Korea, Pyongyang, strike the nuclear weapons installations, and strike the forces on the frontier with nuclear weapons. We have low-yield nuclear weapons. Do I think that's a good idea? What would the Chinese think about that? How would they be sure that if we launched these weapons, they weren't directed at them? We'd be breaking the nuclear taboo. But if we're not going to be the first country to use nuclear weapons, I don't see how we can deal with North Korea in that decisive way. So what can we do that we haven't done already? We can't do it without Chinese cooperation. The Chinese have more influence, although it turns out to be somewhat limited influence on the North Koreans. The Chinese don't like having a semi-rogue state. The only thing we can do that we really haven't done before in a full sense is try to engage with the North Korean leadership. I mean, really engage. What would we do? We would enter into a non-aggression pact with them. They would want us, of course, to withdraw our forces from the peninsula. There is no, you know, there are some problems. We are a can-do nation. But there are some problems that do not admit to immediate solutions, and I think North Korea is one of them. Now, if we think the North Korean leadership is insane, but then is any leadership insane? I think most leaderships are still inclined to self-preservation. Were they to attack the United States with a bomb, we would obliterate North Korea. That's what our nuclear forces are for. They know that's what we would do. So we survived the Cold War through deterrence, and that's the principal way of dealing with North Korea, deterrence, and hope that this regime will gradually change. Nothing stays the same. Nothing. This regime will change, But in what direction? How? We don't know. It's just one of the great imponderables of foreign policy. I think the Chinese share many of our anxieties about North Korea. But for reasons which are not hard to understand, they're not prepared to bring down or threaten to bring down the regime, which they probably could by isolating it economically. But they don't, first of all, they don't want, 30 million Koreans trying to enter China. Nor do they want North Korea to be unified under South Korean auspices and then have an ally of the United States right on their border. But their main problem is they don't want anarchy in North Korea. And we don't want anarchy there either, because all of those nuclear materials are there. In a state of anarchy, it would be even more dangerous, possibly. So that's not a very satisfactory answer, but it is, I think, a direct answer. Ah, great, go ahead.
The longer we wait, the worse it gets. I don't think that leadership there is open to any kind of negotiation in a meaningful way.
Well, if it's negotiation to eliminate their nuclear weapons capacity, when they first started down that road, they might have been open to it if we could persuade them that there was no, that we did not have as our objective the destruction of the regime. But at this point, that's non-negotiable, I think, because after Iraq, how can any government think that it is safe unless it has safe from being overthrown by a foreign power, unless it has nuclear weapons? It's a huge deterrent, even having one or two. And therefore, I think that is non-negotiable. I wish it were, but I don't see it as being negotiable. So that's the problem. I think it's just, I hate to admit anything's insoluble, but this is one of those cases where I think deterrence, cooperation with the Chinese, and hoping that deterrence works.
Peace in our time.
Very precarious peace in our time.
Yeah. We're going to go to another question over on this side here.
I didn't know exactly how to formulate this, but could you reflect on the UN's role in some of the priorities you've outlined in these last four questions?
When we refer, we being all of us and everybody I know, refer to the UN, we often refer to it as if it were a single entity with a mind of its own, but it isn't. It's a number of things, and we have to decide to what dimension of that umbrella term we are referring. The UN is, on war peace issues, is essentially the Security Council. So it's not some international bureaucracy, it's the great powers. If we're talking, we could be talking about a bureaucracy, the Secretariat as it's called, a hierarchically organized institution with the Secretary General at the top, which services the various parts of the UN, including the Security Council. It does studies, it organizes conferences, it generates norms, rules, principles. Many of the post-war treaties are universal treaties. That is, they begin with a General Assembly resolution. The torture treaty, for example. You start with a General Assembly resolution proposing that the International Law Commission develop a draft of a treaty on torture, and then the International Law Commission, which is staffed by independent legal experts, develops a draft. And it's circulated among countries, and they comment, and the draft is reshaped, and finally, if there appears to be a consensus, then there's a diplomatic conference, and countries sign on or don't sign on, or sign on with reservations, and ultimately the law of the sea is perhaps the prime example, where the traditional rules of the law of the sea began to break down because they're mostly customary. For example, the territorial sea. Well, for a couple of centuries, the territorial sea, that is the part of the sea that was regarded as literally an extension of your land. So you had sovereign rights over that sea. It was regarded as being 3 miles. And then countries began pushing individually out from the 3 mile limit and became increasingly chaotic. And finally, there was a consensus among leading states that we needed to actually develop a new body of rules reflecting, among other things, changes in technology. For example, as the law of the sea was evolving, there was no capacity for undersea mining or exploration. By 1945, there was. So with the changing technology, you needed new rules. And so they went through that very process. It took 10 years to negotiate the law of the sea. And we had our positions, we made some compromises. In the end, we didn't ratify the treaty. Although we did say that in important areas, the treaty reflected our view of international law. That's just one of hundreds of examples of how the international system is governed by rules and principles. So we could be referring to the Security Council. We could be referring to the sort of law-generating aspect of the United Nations. We could be referring to this bureaucracy which participates in that process. We could be referring to the functional or technical organizations, the World Health Organization, which is important for coordinating international responses to Ebola or other potentially pandemic diseases, or the UN Food and Agricultural Organization. And there are other specialized, the UN High Commissioner for Refugees, which is dealing with about 20 million or more refugees. Now, those are the officially recognized refugees. So there are all these specialized agencies which have their own boards. And the membership of the board is largely determined by contributions to the particular organization. So in the case of the UN High Commissioner for Refugees, which is a big bureaucracy, Scandinavian countries have an important role on the board because they contribute a great deal, independent of their small contribution to the UN, based upon their population and resources, because they're big contributors. So these are all different facets of this umbrella term, the UN. So, it depends upon the issue. At the UN, one of the advantages of the UN as a forum is as a forum. That is, you can communicate with unfriendly states, or states you've decided are enemies at the moment, in an informally in the corridors of the UN, at the General Assembly meeting. And also, you get a sense of where there is a broad consensus about what kinds of actions will be regarded as a violation of the general interests of the international community and what ones aren't. So you can see where the red lines of international public opinion are, and even if that's international elite public opinion, it's still a useful bit of information. So it's a complex institution. It's almost a set of institutions under a single name. I left out the whole peacekeeping aspect of the United Nations. I was involved in the Somali peacekeeping operation in 1993. It didn't work out very well. Terrible tactical and strategic decisions were made. But there have been very successful peacekeeping operations which saved lives and which stabilized states where order had broken down. So there are a couple of dozen operations going on at the present time. The UN doesn't have enough troops. The UN doesn't have any troops. When you want an operation, you go around, the Secretary General goes around begging, basically, countries to provide units for the force. And it's not a very efficient system, because when these units go out to a place, I mean, there are two kinds of peacekeeping operations, basically. There's the kind of operation where the party, assume there's a conflict or a latent conflict, the parties actually want a UN force there to keep them apart. Or if they've reached a armistice, to monitor the armistice, make sure no one is cheating. Then there are the operations where government is broken down, they're a group of contending militias or paramilitary groups, and they don't want any outside actors. Or each of them wants an outside actor on its side, of course. And then there's a possibility that the UN, it's not a peacekeeping force then, because there is no peace to keep. Then the UN is there to enforce a Security Council resolution, which is probably calling for disarmament of the parties or separation of the parties, protection of human rights, the beginning of reconciliation, the rebuilding of the state, and so on. Now, in a case like that, the various militias or paramilitary groups are probably going to test the UN force, particularly if they think that the UN presence is more advantageous to one side rather to another side than to them. Even if the UN force doesn't intend to be, if you intervene unintentionally, you can affect the balance of power, particularly if one thinks it's stronger than the other. If you're not there, if the UN force isn't there, then it thinks, okay, I can win this war. The UN is preventing me from winning this war, so let's get the UN out. Well, then the UN, you have to have a force there capable of defending itself, and including preemptive operations. That means you have to have some decent troops, and it helps to have some air power. And that's not so easy to find, because the U.S. usually doesn't want to lend its troops for that. And the Chinese haven't been willing to until recently. So one of the ways I think international order could be advanced is if the countries that have effective fighting forces would be to designate portions, could be small portions, we don't need vast numbers, but portions of those forces to participate in UN peace operations. A good case of that, you know, Argentina and Chile are historically enemies. They almost went to war a number of times in the last 40 years. Now, the relationship is transformed. And actually, there is a combination. There are Argentine and Chilean troops training jointly for UN peacekeeping operations. It's the one instance I know of, but it's a very nice precedent. Also makes it even more unlikely that there'll ever be a conflict between China and between Chile and Argentina. And actually, you can see that I know something about the Argentine military, and I can see that the mindset has changed. They no longer think in terms of a possible war with Chile. So in a way, in a kind of indirect way, the UN peacekeeping idea has contributed to the warming up of relations in a part of Latin America. That was a long-winded answer, but that's a big question.
Speaking of Latin America, we've got two questions over on this side. Hopefully we can get to the last couple of questions.
Being of good fortune, I had the opportunity to live in Cuba for quite a long time. And I'd like to ask you what you think the approach to rehabilitation, if you want to put it that way, would be to get Cuba back on its feet.
Well, as a preface, can I say that we've done some smart things, some wise things in foreign policy over the decades, and we've done some really stupid things, and the stupidest of all was the embargo of Cuba. We were the enablers of the Castro dictatorship. This is a country 90 miles from the United States. It's a country sort of inundated with U.S. culture, a country that loves baseball. But we should have flooded, and unless Castro forcibly stopped us, we should have flooded Cuba with doctors, lawyers, dentists, baseball players, coaches, anything. We should have forced Castro to isolate his country. Then he couldn't have said that all the economic problems that his policies produced was the fault of the United States embargo. No, it was your fault. So it was a stupid policy, but I said policy is often shaped by the framework. How could this, if I could just use a Lyndon Johnson term, how could this pissant little country defy the United States? It's just intolerable to us that it could do so. It was a very emotional, childish reaction. A great power should never act childishly. It should act like a great, confident power. And then the role of ethnic groups in shaping foreign policy. So we carried on this policy for 50 years, and finally we stopped. And many politicians who continued to advocate for the embargo publicly, privately would say, yeah, it's a failure. But publicly, they maintain their position. It's very two-faced in many cases. What can we do now? Well, what we could have done before. To the extent that this government, the Castro era is ending. Raul will die soon. Fidel demonstrated that, yes, there is an end to life. And Raul will soon be passing from the scene. A whole generation is passing from the scene. A new generation is arising. And Cuba is changing before our eyes. And that change will accelerate. I don't think there's any way they can avoid it. There are many companies, there are many investors who want to get involved in Cuba. It will happen. The Cubans want to preserve the education system, the health system, the things that Castro did in the first 5 or 10 years of his rule, which changed Cuba in a desirable way. Then it turned out that he was just another Latin American caudillo, and that he couldn't stop. If he'd run for office in a democratic election, let's say 5 to 10 years after the revolution, he would have won. But he decided not to go that route because of his ego, well, because he was an egomaniac, as all caudillos are. Power was corrupting, or maybe he was corrupted to begin with. But he had some ideas. But you know, that, in a way, it's simple. All we have to do is to let the cultural and commercial and financial presence of the U.S. and other countries act on the basis of the normal incentives for acting. Cuba will change, and it will change for the better. Now that, I'm confident.
I have our last question over here.
Professor Farrar, if the U.S. can promote democracy and human rights around the world, including in Russia, can Russia not promote authoritarianism and repression within the United States?
Well, to slightly depoliticize that question, let's talk Europe. Is it not clear? I hate to put it that way, because that makes it a rhetorical question. I hate rhetorical questions. My observation is that Putin wants to undermine liberal democracies. I'm using the word liberal in a very broad sense, not in the narrow sense that we use it here in American politics. Liberal democracies in Europe. Then I think the answer is yes, he does. Why? Well, for one reason could be that if liberal democracies are thriving, it is a comment on the kind of government that they have in Russia. It's a bad example. While if liberal democracies are decaying, are degrading, that's good. That shows that what his version, Putin's version, of participatory government is a desirable form of government. I think, beyond that, I think it's just a desire to sow chaos and distrust. It's really, what he's more interested in, I think, is stoking a very intense parochial kind of nationalism, because that will break up the EU, and that will break up NATO, and that will move the US out of Europe. It will break up the whole Western alliance. So I don't think it's so much a question of democratic government as such that he cares about. It's encouraging xenophobic forces, hyper-nationalism, because that will lead to, if you look, just look at the platforms of the nationalist parties, it will break up Western unity. That, and if I were in his place, I suppose that's the policy I would pursue. Then the West will be weak, and powers is a relative concept. If the West is weaker, Russia is necessarily stronger. So it's a rational policy. It's a policy that we should combat with all of our strength and ingenuity.
Well, thank you very much, Tom.